Okay, how are things on
We're
your
good,
end?
Mr. Perry.
Okay.
Our sound working and everyone's here, so we're ready when you are.
Okay. What kind of caseload do you have and what are you most interested in?
Well, I think in general, we have several cases of stuttering at the elementary level primarily. And, you know, the traditional techniques that we've all learned are not terribly beneficial. So we're open to something new. And
okay.
So we heard about you and we want to know more.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so we have a couple of kindergartners, first graders, and some 14-year-olds.
We're talking about the original cause of dysfluency. It can be a lot of different things. It could be demands in capacity, inherited traits, neurological weaknesses, delayed speech or language development, or various emotional factors. And we don't know sure what it is. It could be different things. Right now, the predominant theory is that it's neurological weaknesses, although I think all the other things may play a role. What they all have in common is the increased perception that speech is difficult and requires effort. It has been estimated that approximately 5% of the children stutter at some time during their childhood. But out of that 5%, about 80% recover spontaneously before adolescence. So one of the issues has been, how can we predict which ones are going to recover and which ones are going to be persistent in their stuttering? The researchers have found that the children who persisted in stuttering were more emotionally reactive. And there's other research that indicated that they're more perfectionistic. This is my theory, that the children who recovered, they may have started with certain developmental delays in their speech and language, and they weren't really that much concerned about it. And after a while, all of that improved and they stopped stuttering. The children who were more emotionally reactive are more concerned about that. And if they're more perfectionistic, it's like, you know, why am I not able to speak as well as my peers or the other people around me? What's wrong with me? And there may be other factors involved with regard to the child's environment. And so what they try to do is to try hard to speak more fluently. And so they're going to use effort to try to get those words out. And it could start at a very simple thing, like simple disfluencies. For example, the child may be asking for something. I want, and the parent is annoyed and says, first of all, that's rude. You should say, may I please have? All right, may I please have? And the urge is to get it out faster and faster. And then somebody may get really annoyed and say, you know, just spit it out. And then we finally get to the point where the repetitions are in shorter and shorter intervals and more rapid. So it could be pop, 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 pop. Or it could get down to just the P. So what I think happens is that the children who are more emotionally reactive get caught up in something where they're using the Valsalva mechanism in order to perform Valsalva maneuvers to try to force the word out. Okay, so they're really trying hard to get the words out with muscular effort, but that does not produce the sounds of speech. It only interferes by blocking airflow. So speech requires very little physical effort, and almost all the effort is for inhalation when we do not speak. This is the Valsalva mechanism. Have any of you heard about the Valsalva mechanism?
Yes.
I don't think it's taught. I have looked at many of the textbooks. I have a whole bunch of them. And I look in the index, and there is no mention of the Valsalva mechanism or the Valsalva maneuver or effort closure of the larynx. Nobody talks about it, so it's not learned. So one of the things that I wanted to do was to make this well known, because I thought that speech pathologists are really missing out on a very important element with regard to stuttering. This is the thing that I discovered way back when I gave up on therapy because nothing was working. And I looked into the medical literature, and this is when I learned about the Valsalva mechanism and the Valsalva maneuver. Okay, so we got different things that can block the ear and can build up air pressure in the lungs. Okay, this is a Valsalva maneuver. There's a larynx. It's like you're holding your breath. The chest muscles contract to push in on the lungs. The abdominal muscles contract in order to push up on the diaphragm in order to constrict the space that is in the lungs and in the chest cavity in order to stiffen the trunk of the body. And down here we have the puborectalis muscle, which is a special little muscle down there that squeezes off the bottom of the rectum so that when we have all the pressure in the abdominal cavity, it doesn't squeeze out an unwanted bowel movement. All these parts act in unison. They all act together. And if you relax any one part of those, well, then you can't do the Valsalva maneuver. Here's the vocal folds. This is what we use for phonation, and the air has to come through this in order to ripple the vocal folds. No muscular effort is required in order to phonate. We just have the air coming through, and it's the airflow that vibrates the vocal folds. All right, but here's effort closure. Here's a cross section. The vocal folds, they come loosely together here. The air comes through and vibrates them. But during effort closure, the vestibular folds and the vocal folds squeeze together to block off the airflow. And the greater the air pressure, the more tightly they squeeze shut in order to resist the air pressure. Because the idea is we're going to build up as much air pressure as we can in the lungs in order to stiffen the trunk of the body, which will help us do things like lifting weights and fighting or bearing down if we're going to push out a bowel movement. Okay, so this is the Valsalva maneuver and effort closure. We can also block off the airflow with the lips or the tongue. There's a lot of concern that people have about the consonants. For example, when I was younger, my last name is Parry. So I might say something like pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa. And the listener might say, oh, you've got problems with your P's. And my answer would be, no, I don't have any problem with my P's. I just said my P's about half a dozen times. The problem was not being able to move on to the vowel sound that followed. What I think happens is that the child gets caught up in something that I call the Valsalva stuttering cycle. It starts off with negative beliefs, fears, expectations, and intentions. And it could be the anticipation of difficulty. Then the part of the brain that's called the amygdala triggers the release of stress hormones and fight, flight, freeze response. The motor program for phonating the vowel sounds is replaced by an effort impulse. There's activation of the Valsalva mechanism and the Valsalva maneuver. There's forcing and other stuttering avoidance behaviors. What happens here with regard to the effort closure and the effort impulse? The urge is to try to force the word out. And that may be done by really pressing with the lips and trying to force out. Let's say that I want to say pizza. I'll have a pip, and I'm pressing hard on the P. After a while, the effort that I'm exerting discharges the effort impulse. And once the effort impulse is discharged, now the word can come out. So I'm going, pizza. And the child is stuck with the impression that the effort and the force help to get the word out. And so that reinforces that behavior. And I've spoken to many people and I say, do you think that forcing on the word or on the consonant helped to get the word out? And that is almost a universal impression. So you get the reinforcement of all the negative beliefs, fears, and behaviors. And so the next time around, when that word comes out, there's more anticipation that's going to be difficult and more of a belief that force and effort is going to get the word out. And so the child gets sucked into this Valsalva stuttering cycle. And over time, the brain creates nerve pathways for acting the Valsalva mechanism during speech. And this was my example here, parry. It's not the P, it's the vowel sound that I'm not saying, because I can't move on to the vowel sound, because a motor program for phonating the vowel sound has been corrupted by the stress hormones. And meanwhile, we don't stutter when we sing, because then our intention is to voice the melody, which is carried by the vowel sounds. When we articulate words silently, or when we whisper, it's much easier, because here we don't have phonation. So the articulation is not the problem. It's the inability to move on to the vowel sound. So I think stuttering blocks are, it's better not to treat them in terms of fluency, but as a substitution of physical effort in place of the vowel sound as a part of a freeze response that's triggered by the brain's amygdala. All right, here's the amygdala. It's a part of the limbic system. Its usual purpose is to help us respond quickly to threatening situations. When it senses danger, it triggers the release of stress hormones and the fight, flight, freeze response. Now, the freeze response not only inhibits physical movement, it also inhibits vocalization. Here is an example. For many hundreds of thousands of years, human beings lived in the wild as hunter-gatherers, and they were subject to attacks by large, ferocious animals as well as rival tribes. So we developed a fight, flight, freeze response, which we share with the other animals. Imagine that this prehistoric man is walking through the plains of Africa, sees a lion, the amygdala senses that this is a dangerous situation, and it triggers the fight, flight, freeze response. Now, it's not very likely that if the lion attacks, he's going to be able to fight off the lion. And it's not likely that he's going to be able to outrun the lion. So the third option is to freeze. So his body becomes motionless. So it will be less likely that the lion will notice him. But it's also important that the lion doesn't hear him. So not only have to be still, you got to be silent. And so the freeze response inhibits vocalization so that you will not be heard. Now, the part of a word that is the loudest part is the vowel sound. If it's a multisyllable word, it's the vowel sound on the stressed syllable. So let's say this should be the part that is most likely to be heard, and that's the part that's most likely to be suppressed. However, if this guy was going to whisper to his friend, you know, shh, there's a lion over there, he could probably whisper okay, because the lion's not going to hear that. There's many other examples with regard to how this is probably true. As you may have heard, that masking, like with the Edinburgh masker, where you hear a loud noise when you try to talk, and so you can't hear yourself speak. The people who stutter tend to be more fluent if they can't hear their own voice. Well, if they can't hear their own voice, then the amygdala can't hear it either. And the amygdala would have no reason to suppress the voice. And I have many, many examples of that that I think support this hypothesis. Okay, so what happens? The intent to vocalize is suppressed and it's diverted to effort closure. The urge to block is very strong because the response was originally a matter of life and death with regard to the fight, flight, freeze response. So it doesn't block silent mouthing or whispering because they're less likely to be heard. And so what you feel you have is a brick wall in the place where the vowel sound should be. When we focus on being fluent, or when we want to try hard to make a good impression by not stuttering, amygdala becomes on high alert for words it associates with stuttering. So for this reason, techniques that work in the therapy may not work in real speaking situations when used with the intention of being fluent. The amygdala works in accordance with our intentions. It not only triggers the fight, flight, freeze response in physically dangerous situations, but nowadays it's mainly in social situations, including speaking situations. And so the more you're worried about not being fluent, and the more you're worried about the difficulty of speech, the more you want to try to be fluent. It's like the amygdala says, oh, you want to be fluent? I can help you with that. So then when the time comes, it triggers the fight, flight, freeze response, and we're stuck not being able to get through the word. Okay, here's an example. Let's imagine that a man or a child goes to a restaurant and wants to have a pizza. But he's very much afraid of the word pizza because he's been having a lot of trouble with his P sounds. So he practices all by himself, pizza, 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 so he can say it perfectly well. And he gets to the restaurant and the waiter comes up and says, what'll you have? And now, because he's so concerned about making a good impression and being able to say pizza fluently, he has invested the word pizza with great emotional importance. And the amygdala responds to this by triggering the stress hormones. And so now he's forcing and forcing, and he's not able to get the P out, but his lips are in exactly the correct position for P. But the more he forces, the tighter his lips close. Now he could say something else like hamburger because he doesn't want a hamburger. But let's say that he decides he really wants his pizza. So he picks up the menu and he points to pizza on the menu. And the waiter says, oh, you want a pizza? And once the waiter says pizza, the spell is broken. And now we can say, yeah, I want a pizza, pizza, pizza. And he can say it all he wants. Because the word pizza has now been divested of all of its importance. Now it's superfluous, it's meaningless. He doesn't have to say pizza because the waiter already knows. So now with this, without the emotional investment in the word, there's no reason for the amygdala to respond. There's a lot of other examples with regard to this. When a patient is in the therapy room and is being taught some kind of speaking technique, it doesn't matter what it is. And he's able to do it perfectly well while he's in the therapy room. The reason is because the amygdala does not get involved because his intention is simply to show the therapist how well he's using the technique. But then he goes out into the real world and his intention now becomes using the technique to be fluent. And it's like the amygdala says, oh, you want to be fluent? I'll help you with that. And so the same thing happens. Now he's trying to be fluent and his vowel sounds are blocked. And he has this tremendous urge to exert effort, ought to force the word out. So this is something that we hear all the time from people who stutters, as well as from therapists, you know. Oh, you know, he used the technique very well in therapy, but it didn't work outside. Why didn't he use it outside? The persons who stutter say, the technique worked, except when I really needed it. And so there's great disillusionment with regard to therapy, because it really doesn't get to the heart of the matter. Okay, so the purpose of Valsalva stuttering therapy, which is what I do, it's not to control a person's speech, but rather to control the forces that interfere with speech, thereby freeing the person to speak more easily and effortlessly. Okay, let's say that we're talking with children. The main thing I want to do is to make sure that the child becomes more able to recover than persists. So I want to try to stop the behaviors and the attitudes that will lead him into persistence. But the most important thing is that speaking, the getting the words out, does not require effort. That words are not physical objects that you can force out of the body. Words are melody and movement. It's like you have a thought, and now you make movements within your mouth. But your mouth shapes the vowel sounds, and it forms the consonants. And it's a continuous vibration, like the air comes out, it vibrates the vocal folds, and you have this vibrating column of air that you now shape into a sequence of sounds. And those sounds go off into the airwaves, and they're picked up by the listener. And if he knows your language, his brain automatically decodes the symbolic sounds into meaning, into the message that you're sending. If you treat a word as if it's a thing to be forced out, it is no longer a word. The word is melody and movement. It's not something that you can force out. And becoming fixated on trying to get out this word is going to defeat the whole purpose of communication. Okay, now, first of all, with the breathing, I might ask, what is easiest, to pump your bicycle up the hill or to coast down the hill? What is hardest and what is easiest? And they all say, well, going up the hill is hardest and coasting down is easiest. Okay, that's the same thing with regard to breathing. In order to exhale, you basically just relax all of those muscles. And speaking occurs as we coast down the hill. So our speech is powered by relaxation instead of effort and force. Okay, do you have any questions so far? Could you tell me something about what are the therapy techniques that you're using with the children? I mean, there's a lot that I've heard about. There's a lot that I've witnessed. Okay, we got easy onset, we got light contacts, and then there's something called turtle talk. You know, you talk real slowly. And then you have something called a bumpy speech. So when the child is not being fluent, you can say something like, oh, your speech was a little bumpy there. You want to try that again? Yeah. What's happening is they're focusing on the external behaviors of stuttering. In fact, the very definition of stuttering that most people have is based on things like the repetitions, the prolongations, the hesitations, the interjections, all of that. You know, the forcing, it's the observable behaviors. For example, some parent might say to me, my child is repeating words. And that is being understood as being stuttering. But that's not really what I'm worried about. Because just because you're disfluent as a child doesn't mean you're going to stay disfluent. Because 80% are going to recover. But if you put a whole lot of emphasis on this, that you got to be fluent, it may cause the child to try harder to be fluent by using the Valsalva mechanism to try to force out the words. And then they'll get stuck on that, and they'll get sucked into the Valsalva stuttering cycle. So what I would rather do is I'd rather focus on relieving the factors that interfere with speech. And these factors are largely, it's the amygdala, it's the Valsalva mechanism, it's the treatment of words as if they were physical objects rather than melody and movement. The idea that forcing on a word is going to eventually get it out. We have to change all of that. And what I do is not focusing on the external fluency per se, but on the underlying factors that make a child feel that he's stuck on a word. And that's basically the common thread or the common experience of real stuttering from the stutterer's point of view. It's the experience of feeling stuck on a word, and all of the rest of the forcing and the repetitions and all the other things are to break through that block, to force the word out, or to delay the block or hide the block. But the real problem is, why is he feeling stuck on that word? What is going on? And how do we relieve that? This is what I do with the kids with regard to breathing. This is for the really younger kids. I have this little wooden train set. It goes up the hill and then comes down the hill. Inhale, exhale. Inhale, and that's when you speak. As we inhale, the diaphragm flattens out to enlarge the chest cavity, and that compresses the abdominal cavity. And all the intestines in there push out on the front of the abdomen. And then when we exhale, all of this relaxes, goes back up, and the front of the abdomen goes back in. So what I would tell the child is put your hand on the front of your abdomen and notice how when you inhale, it bulges out. And then as you exhale, it goes back in. Inhale, bulges out. Exhale, it goes back in. So when it's going back in, when the abdomen is relaxing, that's when you talk. And it's good to talk in phrases, each phrase of information. So we speak in phrases, and then we take a breath. And then we say the next phrase. This is particularly helpful, I've found, with children who get all blocked up when they're trying to explain something that they're excited about. For example, some kind of video game. And they're explaining it to their parent or whatever, and they get very excited. And then they start blocking, and they have a hard time getting the stuff out. So what I've been telling them to do is, okay, you're going to do the breathing. Break it into phrases, okay? Each phrase is a chunk of information, and then you go on to the next chunk of information, and that also helps the listener understand what you're talking about. So I would have the child explain to me about a video game or something using phrases, you know, one phrase at a time. And meanwhile, keeping track of their breathing and relaxing the abdomen rather than forcing. There's something else that I have found to be helpful, and this may not work with the very young children. It has to do with something called the puborectalis muscle. It's a good thing to relax the abdomen, However, sometimes you need a little bit of tension there for breath support. But the puborectalis muscle has nothing to do with breathing or speech, but it is part of the Valsalva mechanism. So there's a couple of things we can do with the puborectalis muscle. Okay, there's the rectum, and it goes around the rectum. When you relax it, the rectum is open. And when you contract it, it squeezes off the rectum. In order to experience the Valsalva maneuver, if you have a heavy desk or something, you can put your fingers underneath it and then try to lift it. Feel what happens in your throat and in your abdomen. If you don't have a heavy table to do it, you can put your hands together, you can clasp your hands, and then you pull them apart, but don't let go. And sense what's happening in your larynx and in your abdomen. And while you're doing that, if you can feel down in the bottom of your abdomen, in the pelvic floor, a muscle that's tightening up, that is probably your puborectalis muscle. And so the idea is we're going to control the puborectalis muscle. And when we inhale, we're going to tighten it. When we exhale, we're going to relax it. So we're not only relaxing the abdomen, we're also relaxing the puborectalis muscle. Tightening the puborectalis muscle is going to be a way that we can discharge the effort impulse. So rather than the effort impulse going to the mouth or the larynx, it'll go to the puborectalis muscle. And then when we relax, it relaxes the Valsalva mechanism because it's a part of the Valsalva mechanism. So while you inhale, you're not going to have a Valsalva maneuver because the air is going in the wrong direction and there's negative air pressure. However, you can discharge the effort impulse. When you relax it, and then you're relaxing the Valsalva mechanism. Okay, so those are important things that you can do. So there we have, there's a neutral position. You tighten the puborectalis as you inhale, and then you relax it as you exhale and speak. Okay, so there's a diagram of the different things. There's a lot of different exercises. One of them has to do with vowel sounds. I have an exercise that uses the vowel sounds ah, eh, e, and oo. The ah is way at the back of the mouth. The eh is a little bit forward. The e is even more forward. And the oo is the most forward because it's in the lips. So what I have them do is the Valsalva relax breathing. In fact, I call it the Valsalva relax PR breathing. PR is for the puborectalis muscle. So this breathing is directed by the tightening and relaxing of the puborectalis muscle. The first thing is you inhale and you shape the vowel sound in your mouth as you inhale. And then you relax the puborectalis and exhale. Don't change the position of your mouth and don't hold back with a glottal stop. So if I was going to do ah, it would be ah. I just glide right back into it. Ah, then I can do it with a rising pitch. Ah, a falling pitch. Ah, up and down pitch. Ah, okay, we do the same thing with eh, e, and oo. And we can do it with any other vowel sound as well. And this idea is that you don't have to force the vowel sound. You can relax, you can shape the vowel sound. As you relax, you can vocalize, ah. All right, so that's another thing that's been very helpful. One of the things that I want to get across is that speech and words are not objects to be forced out. They're melody and movement. You have the melody with the inflection and the pitch of your voice. And then you have different loudness and you have all the other things that are considered prosody. prosody is how we express ourselves as individuals. It affirms us. It's a way of asserting ourselves. So we express ourselves through the melody of our voice. I'm not talking about singing. I'm talking about the natural inflection and prosody. So here is a computer diagram of I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. And you notice how the pitch goes up and down. Now the key vowel sound for the phrase is going to be the loudest and it's going to have the highest pitch. You know, I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. Right? Focusing on the prosody rather than trying to force the word out is the first thing that we've got to do. And one of the ways we can do that is to hum. So the way that I want to hum is what I call velar humming. The back of the tongue is up against the lowered soft palate or velum, as when you're making the ng sound in thing, bring, thing, etc. We keep the back of the tongue in the velar position as we inhale, and as we exhale and vocalize. Okay, now there's a reason for that. The first thing we start off with is we're humming the melody. I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. And meanwhile, you're doing the Valsalva Relax PR breathing. All right, that's the melody. And now we're going to put words to it, but we're not going to start off by actually saying the words. We're going to continue to hum, but just articulate with our mouth. And that's why we're doing the velar humming, in order so the front of the tongue and the mouth are able to silently articulate the words. Like, and I call this Humdronian speech, because it starts with a hum, and it's followed by the drone of phonation. Okay, now this sounds weird, and it's not supposed to be a speaking technique. This is an exercise. So we're always thinking of the melody, we're humming the melody, we're just articulating the words. So this divides speech into melody and movement. In this way, they are both separated from one another. And so one does not interfere with the other. Back when I was trying to overcome my stuttering and I learned about the Valsalva mechanism, all of that, one of my big questions was, well, what kind of exercise can I do that's going to work? Okay, the two things that I knew that I could do without stuttering was humming, or just voicing a vowel sound, and silent articulation. So I said, well, what if I put them together? I do them both at the same time, but independently of one another. So that's when I started the Humdronian speech. I actually call it something before that, but once I started therapy with participants, I switched to Humdronian. So it's like, after doing that for a while, I moved to something called modified Humdronian. So we start off with a little hum, a velar hum, and then as we start to articulate, we let the air come through the mouth. Okay, so we're vocalizing and articulating. So it'd be like, I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. And this is usually very easy to do. However, it still sounds a little strange. So the next thing I call resonant Valsalva Relax speech, where we still do the initial hum, but we do it silently. We don't start voicing until we get to the actual words and we glide into the words. So it'd be like, I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. So we got the melody. You're still thinking about the movement. And that I have found to be a very effective speaking technique. And it sounds completely normal. And yet you're doing the Valsalva Relax PR breathing. You're thinking the hum, you're thinking the melody, and the movement is a continuous movement. Okay, here's the velar humming with an up and down pitch. All right, here is a diagram of the full hum dronian. You're phonating. The back of your tongue remains in the position, and the airflow comes to the nose. Your silent articulation, or how are you today? But all you hear is All right, the next one would be the modified hum dronian. You hear the okay. This is back of the tongue, is in the position. You start exhaling through your nose while you're phonating. And so you hear the first. How are you today? And for the resonant Valsalva Relax speech, it's the same thing. You have the back of the tongue there. You're exhaling through your nose. You articulate, but you don't start to phonate until you are articulating. And this is an exercise that I call SMEECH. It stands for slow motion, extremely emotive speech. This is another way of emphasizing words as melody and movement. And it's basically what we do is we just exaggerate this. We stretch it out as much as possible and we exaggerate the inflection. And so it sounds really weird, but it'd be like, I'll have a pepperoni pizza, please. Sounds really weird. However, you're stretching out the movement, makes you more aware of the continuous movement. And by exaggerating the inflection, it makes you more aware of the melody of speech. Okay, so you do that a few times. And then you repeat it with the same focus on the melody and movement. But each time you do it, it is incrementally not as long and not as exaggerated until you get to a point where it sounds pretty normal. So the first thing I would call exaggerated SMEECH, and that ends up with moderate SMEECH. So it's a little slower maybe, and it has melody in it, but it doesn't sound abnormal. Good morning. How are you today? And then we have a whole lot of sentences and phrases. Now these can be used for any one of the exercises. You could start off, you know, with hello, or you could use it for the hum dronian or whatever you want. When you actually get a block, in order to dissolve it, you must address its main elements, neutralize the effort impulse, and restore the motor program for phonating the vowel sound. You know, here is the effort impulse as it's directed to the larynx, or it can be directed to the mouth. And what we're saying, let's direct it to the PR muscle. And so that's not going to interfere with speech. Okay, there's something else that I have here, the consonant vowel word exercise. Some children have an overwhelming urge to try to force on the consonant. So I developed this little table. It has the vowel sounds at the top of each column, and then the consonants at the beginning of each row. And the idea is that consonant is only an opening for the vowel sound. We're not going to try to say the consonant at all. And we can put our lips in a relaxed resting position for the B, for example, but our whole intention is to voice the vowel sound. So we have like box, pop, watch. Okay, so you're not trying to say it. Your whole intention is focused on voicing the vowel sound. So this is an exercise that we use. There's another exercise. It's called a picture naming table. And I have a lot more pages of this. So depending whatever the exercise we're doing, name the picture using the exercise, and then use that name in a sentence. And so we can go through this whole thing. Okay, so that's the basic idea, and there's a lot more that I could talk about. But I'd like to really focus on the children that you're working with and what their problem is and what you think might work with them.
We'll try to generate a list of questions.
Okay.
That we have for you.
Okay.
So we'll be back here in 10 minutes.
Very good. Thank you.